Yes, we are live now.
Hello everyone, welcome to the White Army Comprehensive Clinical Class. The White Army is privileged to have Dr. Malini K.V. Ma'am, Professor and HOD of OBG from Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee Institute of Medical Sciences, Bengaluru, as our mentor today. A warm welcome to you, ma'am.
Yeah. Retired professor and head of the department from BMCRI, okay?
Yes, ma'am. Ms. Neha, fourth year MBBS student from BMCRI, Bengaluru, has volunteered to present a case on abnormal uterine bleeding today. Welcome to you, Neha.
Thank you.
I welcome all the attendees to the session. Without further ado, with our mentor's permission, we shall begin the session. Shall we begin, ma'am?
Yeah, of course, you can start.
A 45-year-old lady, a housewife by occupation, whose husband's name is Mr. P, a coolie by occupation, income 1,500 rupees per month, from a lower middle class family. The last menstrual period was 4th August 2020. The date of examination was 8th August 2020, and she was examined 2 days later on 10th August 2020. She's a para 2 living 2. She presented with a chief complaint of heavy menstrual flow since 4 months and pain abdomen during menstruation since 4 months.
Just, you have to give a pause. I may ask you to stop somewhere. Okay. Go to the first slide. Yeah, I kept on telling you started with the this thing. Okay. 42-year-old woman, you started like that. But again, husband's name, Mr. P, is not needed. Okay.
Yes,
right. Yeah. LMP. LMP is important in case of obstetric case, okay, not in gynae. Okay. So you don't have to write LMP in the beginning itself in case of a gynae case.
Yes, ma'am.
Understood? Yes. So it could be a prolapse case or whatever case, you know, like it could be any case. Mm-hmm. So you don't have to write the LMP in the beginning itself in gynae case. You have to write it only when you are taking menstrual history.
Okay.
You got that point?
Yes,
yeah,
ma'am.
And this date of admission and examination, in the exam also you are going to tell like this only? Patient was admitted, okay, but you would have examined on that particular day of exam, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So date of admission, maybe patient was admitted so many days back with the complaint of whatever, you can say like that, mm-hmm. Right? But otherwise, it is of not much of importance, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And even para 2 living 2. Here in gynae case, you are telling about the patient details first, and straight away you are going for the complaints.
Okay.
Okay, she was admitted for what complaint, or she was admitted, or she has come to the OPD, or whatever it is. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Depending upon where you have examined.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so parity or the parity index and the LMP need not be mentioned in the beginning in gynae case. That's all.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Right. Carry on. Second slide. Yeah. So she had heavy menstrual bleeding since 4 months and pain abdomen during menstruation. Okay. Fine. Yeah. Go ahead.
History of presenting illness. Patient was apparently normal 4 months back, and later she developed prolonged and heavy menstrual bleeding during her cyclical menses, which was insidious in onset and lasted for 8 to 9 days. She used to change 7 to 8 fully soaked baths per day compared to her previous cycles, which were of 3 to 4 days, requiring only 2 to 3 baths per day. She also complains of waking up at night to change her pad. It is associated with passage of clots. She also complains of pain in the lower abdomen since 4 months during menstruation. The pain appears few days before, is maximum in the beginning, and subsides after menstruation. The pain lasts for...
Complete, I'll tell you. Yeah.
The pain lasts for 8 to 9 days, is intermittent and dull aching type, non-radiating, and was relieved on taking medications. There's no history of discharge PV. There's no history of intermenstrual bleeding and post-coital bleeding. There's no history of mass per abdomen or mass per vagina. There's no history of burning, micturition, increased urinary frequency or urinary retention. There's no history of passage, or no history of difficulty in passage of stools, and no history of loss of appetite or significant weight loss.
Okay. Menstruals. Okay. Right. Yeah, you finish the menstrual history, then we will go back. Yeah. Complete your menstrual history.
Age of Menarch was 14 years. Her last menstrual period was on 4th August 2020. Her past cycles were of 3 to 4 days. It was regular, a normal flow with no dysmenorrhea, using 2 to 3 pads per day, and cycle was 28 to 30 days duration. Present cycles are 8 to 9 days of bleeding. There's passage of clots and there's dysmenorrhea and usage of 7 to 8 pads per day and cycle length of 28 to 30 days. There's no discharge per vagina.
Yeah. Now you go back one previous slide. Go back. Okay. So do you think this bleeding is abnormal?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Why do you say it is abnormal?
Ma'am, the bleeding is abnormal because it is it's described as heavy menstrual bleeding compared to her previous cycles, and it's also lasting for a longer duration of 8 to 9 days.
And how do you define abnormal uterine bleeding?
Ma'am, if there's if the number of days of bleeding are between 4 to 8, then it could be normal, but this is more than that.
No, see, there is something called, you know, definition of abnormal uterine bleeding, right? How do you define abnormal uterine bleeding?
Any change in frequency, any change in the regularity, frequency, and association of pain can be abnormal uterine bleeding.
No, anything which deviates, any abnormal bleeding from the genital tract which deviates from the normal menstruation is abnormal, isn't it?
Yes,
then definitely I'll ask you, what do you mean by normal menstruation? What is normal menstruation? When do you say it is normal?
A normal menstruation is when the cycle length is around 21 to 35 days, the average length being 28 days per cycle, and the number of days of bleeding being around 4 to 8 days. And the average length is around 4 to 6 days. And the normal blood loss should be around 20 to 80 ml. Yes, ma'am. And the cycles should not vary with more than 20 days of difference between each cycle.
Now, in that you said 21 to 35 days.
Yes, ma'am.
Understood. Not, you know, the frequency should be once in 21 to 35 days.
Yes,
even the duration of flow, it is about, say, 3 to 5 days is normal. Anything more than 7 days is abnormal. Okay. So you think that, see, this is a comparative analysis most of the time, isn't it?
Yes.
She compares her present cycles to the previous cycles, right? So, she will not be able to measure the blood loss, isn't it? Of course, there are so many methods of measuring the menstrual blood loss. Any methods you know?
Ma'am, there's a pictorial representation that we can show her, which has images of how much soap the pad is, so that
okay. Pictorial assessment of blood chart. Okay. Which is the most accurate method?
Most accurate method
of measuring the menstrual blood loss?
I'm not sure.
Yeah, it is alkali hematin method, but all these things are not practical, understood?
Mm-hmm.
So usually, you know, whenever a woman comes and she gives history compared to her previous cycles, if the number of pads are increased, as you said, like she is changing, even at night time, she gets up and she changes her pad, that surely shows that there is heavy bleeding, isn't it?
Yes.
Any other history which indicates that she is having heavy menstrual bleeding?
Ma'am, the passage of clots also indicates that she's having.
Yeah, it. Why do you say that? So you mean to say menstrual blood doesn't clot?
Ma'am, it clots, but then the fibrinolytic mechanism is generally sufficient to break the clots. But when the bleeding is too heavy, it overwhelms the fibrinolytic mechanism and clots will be seen.
Yeah. So whenever when the bleeding is too much, so that the menstrualizing cannot cope up with that much of bleeding, then there will be passage of clots. So all these, like by history, you can make out that there is heavy menstrual bleeding, right? Yeah. Now you said like she has got pain, okay? Pain which is a few days before menstruation, maximum in the beginning, and subsides after menstruation. So what happens during menstruation? Have you heard of triple dysmenorrhea?
Yes, ma'am. What is it? That happens in endometriosis, which has pain before, during, and after menstruation.
Okay. Now, according to you, what kind of dysmenorrhea she's having?
Ma'am, congestive dysmenorrhea.
Yeah. So this is a sort of congestive dysmenorrhea because, yeah, it starts about four days, few days prior to the menstruation, isn't it?
Yes.
So what is the kind of, spasmodic dysmenorrhea means? What will be the kind of history?
Ma'am, spasmodic dysmenorrhea, the pain starts when the menstruation starts, and it's generally maximum on the first or second day, and then it decreases. And it's because of the spasm, because of PGF2 alpha that's released, prostaglandin.
Yeah, usually it is a primary kind of dysmenorrhea, understood, where there is no cause, right? Mm-hmm. And it will last only for a few hours on the first day, that's all, understood?
Yes.
And usually she will be having severe kind of a spasmodic type of pain. Which will be associated with the vomiting sometimes, okay? So this kind of a pain is called as spasmodic dysmenorrhea, usually common in younger girls, understood?
Yes. Yeah.
So this is a kind of a congestive dysmenorrhea which tells us that, okay, there could be some pelvic pathology, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. See, many a times now in gynae, like whatever, when we take history, by history itself, we'll have to come to a certain kind of a clinical diagnosis, okay? Examination definitely will help you in making some kind of a diagnosis. And by investigation, we'll be confirming the diagnosis, okay? So history taking is very, very important.
Yes.
Now, coming to your next slide. Okay. So you said about no history of discharge per vaginum. What kind of discharge you were wanting? You were asking, and why did you ask about history of discharge? See, whenever you ask a negative history, you should know like why you are asking. What is the relevance of that particular negative history?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I asked history of discharge because she's having congestive dysmenorrhea. It could also be because of pelvic inflammatory disease. Mm. In that, we have foul-smelling discharge. And there's also discharge in, it could be there in polyp.
Okay, fibroid polyps. Okay, fine. Yeah. Now, usually, you know, suppose there is a fibroid polyp, what kind of dysmenorrhea they'll have?
Ma'am, they'll have intermenstrual bleeding and postcoital bleeding. And the dysmenorrhea will be congestive. Yes, ma'am.
Fibroid polyp. See, usually fibroid polyp, just before it becomes manifest as fibroid polyp, no, they'll have spasmodic type of dysmenorrhea, okay? So, because the uterus will try to expel this fibroid down, so it will be manifested as this thing. Once it comes as fibroid polyp, he may not have dysmenorrhea, but she may have this kind of discharge, intramenstrual bleeding and foul-smelling discharge, okay? Yes. Anything else? She's 42-year-old. Heavy menstrual bleeding.
For discharge PV, that's what I was thinking.
Huh. Can you think of anything else? You told us about infection. You told us about benign neoplasms. Anything else you can think of?
Ma'am, adenomyosis.
Adenomyosis, she may not have discharge.
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, genital tuberculosis.
Genital tuberculosis in this case, para to living to, quite unlikely, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
CA cervix.
Yes, ma'am.
She's in the reproductive age group, isn't it? See, yes. Always, you know, whenever patient has got abnormal uterine bleeding, just you remember that by age wise itself, you can come to a certain conclusion about the pathology. Okay. Yes. Now suppose she's in the what age group?
She's 42 years old.
So what age group it is? Reproductive, perimenopausal, what is it?
Ma'am, it's reproductive, but reaching perimenopausal.
Yeah, I wouldn't say it is reaching menopause. Anything above 45, maybe you can call it as premenopause.
Okay.
Okay. But up to what is the reproductive age group? When do you say it is reproductive age group? From when to when?
Ma'am, from around 15 years to 45 years.
It is 15 to 49 years. Remember, understood. Up to 49 years, it is reproductive age group. That's why I said, like, you see, if she's less than 45, still she will be in the reproductive age group.
Okay.
So if she's above 45 and because still she's in the reproductive age group, so the disease-wise, like what you can think first. So if there is heavy menstrual bleedings in the reproductive age group, the first thing that comes to your mind is?
Complications of pregnancy.
Yeah, very good, yeah. So complications of pregnancy should be ruled out. Even if she's tuberculosis sometimes, now, there could be recanalization and failure of tubectomy and problems because of pregnancy, right?
Yes.
So pregnancy complications, you must think first. Next.
Ma'am, it could be endometriosis, adenomyosis.
No, I would say infections. You have to rule out infections next, okay?
Yes.
So pregnancy-related problems and pelvic infections. Third would be your benign tumors. Okay, benign lesions of the uterus. I would call it like call it as benign lesions of the uterus. So, what are those things that you can think of?
Not sure.
This is adenomyosis. You have to think. No, adenomyosis or in pelvic endometriosis. What is the difference between adenomyosis and pelvic endometriosis?
Ma'am, the endometrium is within the myometrium in adenomyosis and
it is correct. It is internal endometriosis, you call it as adenomyosis. External endometriosis, you call it as pelvic endometriosis, right? So it could be endometriosis, either internal or external, whatever, okay? Or it could be, what else? Any other benign neoplasm you can think of?
Ma'am, it could be leiomyoma,
yes, very good. Yeah.
Ma'am, it could be hyperplasia of the endometrium.
It could be anything. Okay, AUBO, right?
Yes,
ma'am. So ovulation disturbances she can have. Yes. Then you think about malignancy, right? As a last thing, okay?
Yeah.
But in the malignancies, which one will come first in the reproductive age group?
Ma'am, endometrial malignancies?
No. Reproductive age group, you should always think of CA cervix.
Okay, yes, ma'am.
Understood. So what is the cause for CA cervix, you tell me? See, we are deviating from the main topic now because, you know, like you should know like what is more common in reproductive age group, young ladies.
Yes, ma'am. The human papilloma virus.
Yeah, it is human papilloma virus. Usually, it is connected with the sexual intercourse.
Yes,
and the women with multiple sexual partners or multiparous women, they are more prone for such things, isn't it? So, CA cervix is seen in younger age group, right? Endometrial carcinoma is seen in older age group. Suppose you had presented to me a 47 or 48 year old lady, I would have said, okay, endometrial carcinoma first and then maybe CA cervix next, okay? Or postmenopausal bleeding, first thing you should rule out is?
Ma'am, postmenopausal could be atrophy of the endometrium.
No, you in malignancies, I'm telling.
Endometrial cancer.
Endometrial cancer, you will think like that. See, that's why age-wise when you take, no? See, if adolescent age group, girls come with the heavy menstrual bleeding, what are the causes you can think of? A woman comes with reproductive age group, what are the things that you can think of? Okay, so you said about the pregnancy related problems, infections, benign neoplasms, and then you think about malignancy. Out of malignancy, CA cervix will come as first, and then you can think about CI endometrium, and also because she is in the reproductive age group, what else you must think? Any iatrogenic causes?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm giving you a clue. She's in the reproductive age group. Now you just imagine she's para to living to not tuberculized. Okay.
She could be some contraceptive devices.
Yes, very good. So IUCD induced menorrhagia, understood? Or even, yeah, if it happened to be a intermenstrual bleeding, maybe you would think that, okay, she was using combined oral contraceptive pill or any injectable contraceptive. So you must think about those things, understood?
Yes.
So that kind of history I was looking for in your negative history here. Understood? Any history of medications, any history of contraceptive usage. So all those no things should come there. Okay. No history of using IUCD. She's been tuberculized. No, not using. I don't know like what, whether she has been tuberculized, because we are not gone to that, this thing. So you must tell whether she has taken any medications. Okay. Anything else you can think of? Can bleeding disorders manifest in reproductive age group?
Ma'am, von Willebrand diseases can manifest.
Yeah, sometimes, yes. So should you not ask about any history of a bleeding, from the gums or whatever, epistaxis and things like that. Sometimes, you know, there might be history, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And history suggests you of any endocrinal disorders. Did you ask about that? Is it important?
Yes, ma'am. Thyroid disorders can have an effect.
Yes. Yes, so that you should ask history of that. Any history of chronic liver diseases?
Yes, ma'am, it can cause.
Yeah, it can cause heavy menstrual bleeding. So all these negative histories should come in your history of presenting illness.
Yes, ma'am.
Understood. So usually, this abnormal uterine bleeding, it's sort of a diagnosis by exclusion. Earlier, we used to diagnose ovulation disturbances only diagnosis by exclusion, understood?
Yeah.
So history itself should exclude so many things. So history of medications, anything else? Now suppose she gives history of she has some cardiac diseases and she has undergone some valve replacement and anticoagulants.
She could be taking anticoagulants, which could, yes.
See, you know everything, but all those things should come in the negative history. Understood? Okay.
Yes.
So history of presenting illness, all this history should be included.
Yes.
Okay. So then only you can come to certain conclusions. So the whole like history of medications means what all medications and what are the problems, like what are the diseases which can cause heavy menstrual bleeding. That should be kept in your mind, and that you have to rule out by your negative history. Understood?
Yes.
Okay. So many things you have left out. So all those things. Now you said history of intermenstrual bleeding, postcoital bleeding. What does it suggest?
Ma'am, polyps can cause intermenstrual and postcoital bleeding.
Okay. Yeah. Contact bleeding. Okay. Then history of mass per abdomen.
Ma'am, a very large leiomyoma can have a mass, and even mass per vagina.
Any other mass per abdomen can cause heavy menstrual bleeding?
Ma'am, if it's an ovarian tumor that is hormone secreting. Like,
yes. Can you name few?
Ma'am, granulosa cell tumor.
And Tikka cell tumor, both can cause endometrial hyperplasia. Understood?
Yes.
So she also can have heavy menstrual bleeding. She may present to you with mass per abdomen. Okay.
Yes.
Then mass per vagina.
Ma'am, again, a polyp can be present in the mass per vagina. Yes, ma'am.
Anything else?
It can even be a leiomyoma that's located there on the lower part.
She cannot have mass per vagina if there is a leiomyoma located. It's only the fibroid polyp can present as mass per vagina. But last case we discussed, you were there?
Yes, ma'am. Prolapse can also.
So can prolapse cause abnormal uterine bleeding?
Yes, ma'am.
What kind of abnormal uterine bleeding it can cause?
Ma'am, that will also be intermenstrual bleeding.
Yeah. So because of decubitus ulcer, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
So that is most important. I thought of, say, when you say mass perversion, you should remember it could be fibroid polyp or it could be decubitus ulceration because of the prolapse. Okay.
Yes.
So both you should tell. And you said about burning, micturition, increased urinary frequency. Why did you ask all these urinary disturbances?
Ma'am, to rule out pressure symptoms. I mean, there can be pressure symptoms because of a leiomyoma or any mass.
Okay. Right. Any pelvic mass causing urinary disturbances. That is the idea of asking this.
Yes.
History of difficulty in passage of stools.
Ma'am, it's rare, but it's the same for pressure symptoms or...
Yeah, very, very rare. Okay, fine. Then history of loss of appetite and significant weight loss you have asked.
Yes, ma'am. That was for malignancy.
Malignancy. Yeah, okay. So any time, like whenever you ask a negative history, you should know like why you have asked. Understood?
Yes.
So a lot of things you should have asked, especially abnormal uterine bleeding, you must be asking so many things, right?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Next. So you said here, okay, menstrual history you have said, and last menstrual period is 4-8. Now, what is the importance of this last menstrual period in this heavy menstrual bleeding case, abnormal uterine bleeding case? Why it is important? Do you think it is important?
Ma'am, just to know how her cycles,
That you are telling, no, past cycle 3 to 4 days, all such things, present cycles also you are telling. But what is the importance of last menstrual period?
Ma'am, to rule out pregnancy.
Mm-hmm.
Not sure, ma'am.
Okay. To rule out pregnancy in a way, yes, okay. It may be because she's in the reproductive age group. We are also thinking about pregnancy-related problems. But what is most important is, like, you may have to, she is 42-year-old, coming with heavy menstrual bleeding. You may have to do an endometrial biopsy. Understood?
Yes.
So do you want to know whether she is in the menstrual phase, premenstrual phase? Suppose you want to do endometrial biopsy, when will you call her for endometrial biopsy?
Ma'am, just after the menstruation ends.
So post-menstrual phase, you'll ask her?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
So I should be asking questions only to Neha, is it? Anybody else can answer? Yeah, somebody has already answered pre-menstrual phase.
Okay, sorry.
Except in very, very rare situation, you will be doing it in post-menstrual phase that I'll be discussing. Understood?
Yes.
But
yes.
Most of the times it is in the pre-menstrual phase. Why it is in the pre-menstrual phase? What do you expect in the pre-menstrual phase usually?
Ma'am, you'd want to see the glands and the...
pre-menstrual phase... which hormone will be there, you know, predominant in the premenstrual phase?
And there will be progesterone.
Oh. If the premenstrual phase is first half of menstrual cycle or second half of menstrual cycle?
Not the second half.
I'm giving you a lot of clues. Okay. Second half means what do you mean by that? Second half, pre-ovulatory or post-ovulatory?
Post-ovulatory, ma'am.
So, post-ovulatory, what kind of endometrium do you expect in a normal woman?
Ma'am, it'll be in the secretory phase. So then,
yes, you expect it to be secretory endometrium. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
You call her in the premenstrual phase and you do an endometrial biopsy and you get proliferative endometrium. What does it suggest? It is normal or abnormal?
Ma'am, it's normal.
Hey, in the premenstrual phase, if you find proliferative endometrium, do you call it as normal? Just now you said it is secretory endometrium.
Yes, ma'am. No, ma'am, it's not normal.
It is not normal. Carcinoma, no, sorry. See, you want to know whether there is something called as AUBO.
Yes, ma'am.
Right? Ovulatory disturbances. Could be one of the common causes. It's almost most of the time it is no ovulatory disturbances in most of the time. Understood?
Mm-hmm.
So whenever a woman comes like this with heavy menstrual bleeding, you may see sometimes hyperplastic endometrium or even proliferative endometrium. So you take an endometrial biopsy, you get so many pictures, understood? So normally in a normal woman, you expect it to be secretory endometrium. And if you see a proliferative endometrium or a hyperplastic endometrium or an atrophic endometrium, whatever it is abnormal.
Yes,
you got that point?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So if it is proliferative endometrium, you know that, yes, there is some ovulatory disturbances in this woman.
Yes,
that is the cause for maybe this heavy menstrual bleeding. Understood? So like that, you see, you should know like why you are doing and why we are asking about that. That is the importance of last menstrual period so that you can plan your procedure. Understood? Okay, fine. Now, anyway, I was discussing about endometrial biopsy. What role the histopathology picture that you get? See, we already discussed one is proliferative endometrium. You can get secretory endometrium. You can get hyperplastic endometrium. So just remember that in almost 25% of the cases, it will be hyperplastic endometrium whenever a woman is having heavy menstrual bleeding. Understood? But sometimes in say in about 13-14% of the cases, it could be secretory endometrium. It could be a normal endometrium, but still she may be having heavy menstrual bleeding. Okay. And so in some cases, it could be proliferative endometrium. Apart from this, what are the other kind of picture that you may get?
Apart from secretory and proliferative, there might be atypical features.
See, hyperplastic endometrium could be simple hyperplasia or it could be atypical. Understood?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So simple hyperplasia will be just, there will be a hyperplasia of the endometrium. That's all. Okay. But there are no atypical changes. The columnar, epicumnal, everything will be same. Understood? But if there is any atypicality, there may be like, you know, abnormal changes in the nuclear size, all those things you may see. It could be a pre-malignant lesion. Understood?
Yes.
So you may see simple hyperplasia. You may see hyperplasia with any atypical changes. Understood? So hyperplasia without any atypical changes, with atypical changes. Understood? That's how nowadays we classify like that. Understood? Simple hyperplasia with atypia, without atypia.
Yes.
So without atypia, we are more worried. Why? With atypia means we are very much worried. Why?
With atypia, ma'am, because it could be suggestive that there's a malignancy and...
Yeah, in about say 8-29% of the cases, they may go in for endometrial carcinoma. Understood?
Yes.
So that's why definitely you cannot ignore her. You have to treat her aggressively. Understood?
Yes.
So that's why this is important. Okay. So that is one kind of histopathology you may get. What are the other kind of picture that you may get?
Ma'am, it could be atrophied.
Atrophic endometrium, yes. So if there is atrophic endometrium, what is the cause for heavy menstrual bleeding? Still, she can have heavy menstrual bleeding, isn't it? What do you think is the cause? Atrophic endometrium, see, hyperplastic endometrium, you said, yeah. What is the cause for heavy menstrual bleeding in hyperplastic endometrium? Okay.
In hyperplastic, there's more endometrial proliferation, so there's more bleeding.
Why do you think?
Ma'am, it will get shed, like there's more surface. I mean,
yeah, it will be so thick, understood? Yeah. So when it outgrows its vascular supply, it starts, you know, shedding, and the shedding will be for a longer period. So naturally, she will have heavy menstrual bleeding. We can understand that. What about in atrophic endometrium? Why there is bleeding?
Not sure.
Okay, so the thinned out endometrium, it is so thinned out that the capillaries underneath the thin endometrium, they are so fragile, isn't it? When the smallest this thing, it may break and she may have heavy menstrual bleeding. So this kind of atrophic endometrium you may see in younger lady girls, you know, younger girls, say adolescent age group, immediately after menarche, sometimes they come with heavy menstrual bleeding. You would have seen, you know, girls are brought by their mothers because there is heavy menstrual bleeding. So in the initial period, there could be atrophic endometrium, and because of the atrophic endometrium, the capillaries will be very fragile and she will have bleeding. So you may see it in the extremes of age group, either in the adolescent age group, or it is not senile endometriosis, sorry. It is just premenopausal when the estrogen is waning off, understood? So in the adolescent age group, the hormones may not be adequate enough to cause proliferative changes, good enough to cause proliferative changes and secretory. See, many a times it may be an ovulatory cycles, isn't it? And estrogen that is secreted also may not be that amount. So the endometrium may be thin. This you should know, because whenever you are treating adolescent girl coming with heavy menstrual bleeding, sometimes estrogen will help her, understood? Because it's a thin endometrium, understood? The same thing, we suppose perimenopausal woman comes where the ovarian function is waning off and estrogen is less and there is atrophic endometrium. We don't give her estrogen at that time, understood?
Yes, ma'am.
That's the difference. Like, see, premenopausal woman, even if it is atrophic endometrium, we don't give her estrogen. Rather, we think of something else for her. Okay. So that is the difference. So atrophic endometrium, you can see in extremes of age group, both in adolescent as well as in the premenopausal women, when the ovarian hormonal function is not optimum. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Anything else you can see? Somebody wrote senile endometriosis. There is nothing like senile endometriosis. There may be senile endometritis, which may cause postmenopausal bleeding. But at the same time, any endometritis in the acute phase, the active phase of endometritis, there can be heavy menstrual bleeding, even including tuberculosis. Understood?
Yes.
So tuberculosis, in the initial period of endometritis, there can be heavy bleeding with the congestion. But once it heals, how it heals?
There's a lot of adhesions formed. So because of all these adhesions, there'll be decreased blood.
So it actually heals by fibrosis. There may be adhesion formation, Seneca formation. Usually we call it as Asherman syndrome, isn't it? So she may have oligomenorrhea or even hypomenorrhea, rather I would say hypomenorrhea, and all those terminologies are gone now, menorrhagia, polymenorrhea, hypomenorrhea, all those things are gone. But sometimes, you know, like by listening to the history of the woman, we will know that what kind of menstrual problem and what we should focus on, okay? So if it is hypomenorrhea, always you must think it could be tubercular endometritis, the end stage, okay? So when the endometrium heals by fibrosis, and hypomenorrhea also can be seen, suppose the woman is taking OC pills, you know, post-pill amenorrhea, you would have heard, one of the side effects of this hormonal pill. Or even say she's taking some DMPA injection or LNGIUS she's having. So all these may cause some hypomenorrhea, decreased flow of menstruation. Finally, sometimes they may land up in amenorrhea also, okay? So these things you should think, you know, hypomenorrhea means all these things you must think. Polymenorrhea means, what is polymenorrhea? Though the terminologies we are not using, sometimes old examiners have seen, like, you know, usually the examiners who come from Tamil Nadu, you know, old examiners, they will ask you, what is polymenorrhea? What is hypomenorrhea? What is menorrhagia? And things like that. What is polymenorrhea?
If the cycle length is less than 21 days, they'll have more
Very
number
good.
Of
cycles. Okay, less than 21 days. Now, what could be the cause here?
Ma'am, pelvic inflammatory disease can cause.
So usually some pelvic condition. It is the ovarian disturbance that is causing this polymenorrhea. Remember that, okay? So usually what happens is, adolescent age group and just before, menopause, premenopausal. So extremes of age group when there can be ovulatory disturbances, she can have this polymenorrhea. And sometimes say after abortion, after delivery, the HPO axis may not come back to normal, function soon. Understood. So in the first few cycles, she may have these ovulatory disturbances, so she can have polymenorrhea. Okay. That is one thing. And pelvic endometriosis or pelvic infection, she can have this polymenorrhea. Oligomenorrhea. What is oligomenorrhea?
When the cycle is less than 2 days, there and the bleeding is very less.
That is hypomenorrhea.
When the cycle length is, when the bleeding period is.
See, somebody is telling you cycle more once in 35 days or more.
Okay.
It is just the opposite of polymenorrhea. Understood. Okay. So the ovulation is infrequent. Where do you get this infrequent ovulation?
Ma'am, if it's an AUBO kind of.
Same, adolescent and premenopausal. It could be either polymenorrhea or oligomenorrhea, one thing. And if the woman is obese.
PCOS.
PCOD, very good, yeah. So in these kind of women, you can have oligomenorrhea. Understood?
Yeah.
Yeah. And sometimes, say, hyperprolactinemia. Or if she is on drugs like, dopaminergic drugs like phenothiazine, cimetidine and things, or alpha-methyl-dopa. So all these drugs, that's why the history of medication is very, very important. Understood? Yeah. So these also can cause oligomenorrhea. Okay. Now, this I just wanted to tell you because, sometimes some examiners might ask you, what is oligomenorrhea? Where do you get oligomenorrhea? Polymenorrhea? What does it mean? And hypomenorrhea means decreased menstrual flow. Oligomenorrhea means it is the frequency is less. Okay. Once in 35 days or what? So don't confuse that with this, okay? So where we were, endometrial biopsy, we have come to here, understood?
Yes,
okay, ma'am. So sometimes you get mixed type of endometrium, okay? There is something called as irregular ripening, irregular shedding. Have you heard of that?
Yes, ma'am, if the luteal phase is, there's problem with the luteal phase and the progesterone is not enough, then it could be hyperestrogenic condition.
It could be irregular ripening. Understood. Irregular. It's in type of ovulatory type of abnormal uterine bleeding. Okay. Irregular ripening and irregular shedding are ovulatory type of abnormal uterine bleeding. Understood. So if there is prolonged function of corpus luteum, there may be something like irregular shedding. Understood. So in that situation, you may get mixed. See, you are doing, suppose I do an endometrial biopsy on fifth day of menstruation, okay? It's a normal woman. On fifth day of menses, I'm doing an endometrial biopsy. What is the picture I might get?
Ma'am, on fifth day, there's already been shedding of the endometrium. So I'm thinking...
After shedding, what happens? Fifth or even say seventh day. Okay, I will say seventh day.
Not sure.
See, the first 3 days, there will be shedding and then immediately the proliferative endometrium starts.
Yes, ma'am.
Growing. Understood. So in the first half of menstrual cycle, you will be seeing proliferative endometrium, dear.
Yes, ma'am.
So in the post-menstrual phase, after menstruation, if you call her and do a DNC, you will get proliferative phase. But if there is irregular shedding, where there is prolonged function of corpus luteum, you may get patchy secretory endometrium also. Understood? Yes. So this is the only time when we call her to come on the post-menstrual phase, where if you are suspecting irregular shedding. Otherwise, in all the situations, we always call her in the premenstrual phase. You got that point?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. So you may get that kind of endometrium. Sometimes there is something called as pill endometrium, you know. They say pathologist will give the report as area stellar reaction. Okay. It's all like maybe it is too much for you. But there is something called as, you know, decidual changes might be seen, because if she's on progesterone only pill, there may be decidualization of the endometrium. Okay. Or OC pills means pill endometrium. They may give the picture as pill endometrium. You may get tubercular endometritis or just endometritis. You may get endometrial polyps sometimes. Understood?
Yes.
Sometimes you may get carcinoma only, endometrial carcinoma. Sometimes stromal sarcoma also, maybe you will get it in endometrial DNC report itself. So these are the various kinds of DNC report that you may get, okay?
Yes.
So you should know like what you might expect in this particular case if I send the endometrial sampling for histopathological examination, what is the kind of report I might get, okay? So that you should have in your mind. Okay, fine. Next. So we are in the menstrual history. Yes.
Obstetric history. She's had 21 years of married life, non-consanguineous marriage, para 2, living 2. The first baby was an institutional delivery, full-time vaginal delivery, male child, born 2 years after marriage, who is currently 19 years old. And the second child was also an institutional full-time vaginal delivery, male child, born 4 years after marriage, currently 17 years old. The patient has not undergone sterilization and there's no history of contraceptive use.
See, very, very important, isn't it?
Yes.
So still you may have to rule out pregnancy-related problems, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Past history. She's not a known case of diabetes mellitus, hypertension, epilepsy, tuberculosis, and she has no thyroid disorders. There's no history of abdominal surgeries or blood transfusions in the past.
What is important in your case? We know the diagnosis here. So retrospectively, when you ask about abdominal surgeries, what you might ask?
Ma'am, abdominal surgeries could have caused additions, or if she has already had, for example, if she had leiomyomas, which and she had it removed, it could be
just simply say myomectomy. History of myomectomy might be important in this case. Okay, yeah.
No significant family history. Personal history, the diet is mixed, appetite is normal, sleep is adequate, bowel and bladder are regular. She's no history of tobacco smoking or alcohol consumption.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Summary, a 42-year-old lady, para 2, living 2, with heavy menstrual bleeding and severe congestive dysmenorrhea since 4 months, with no other significant complaints and no other comorbidities. She's probably an abnormal uterine bleeding L or AUBA for further evaluation.
Okay, you didn't do a parabnormal examination?
Ma'am, yes ma'am, I've done it. It's after this.
But then why do you put the summary in between? See, summary should come at the end of your examination. Understood?
Okay.
So yes. You are allowed to do a parabnormal examination, up to parabnormal examination. You do that and then give the summary.
Okay, yes, ma'am. Shall I go on to examination?
Yeah. Summary should come always at the end of your examination.
Okay, yes, ma'am. Examination. Patient is moderately built and nourished, cooperative, and is examined with adequate exposure after taking consent. Her body weight is 62 kgs and height is 158 centimeters, which is a BMI of 24.84 kg per meter square.
So she is not obese?
Yes, ma'am.
So no thyroid, okay, fine. Yeah, you're written.
Pallor is present. Icterus sinosus clubbing, lymphadenopathy and edema are absent. Thyroid is normal. Breast examination is normal and spine is normal.
Okay.
Vitals, pulse rate is 74 beats per minute and blood pressure 120/80 millimeters mercury. Respiration rate is 18 cycles per minute and the patient is afebrile.
Okay.
Systemic examination. cardiovascular system, S1 and S2 heard normally and there's no murmurs. Respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sounds heard equally on both sides and there are no added sounds. Central nervous system, clinically no abnormalities detected. Abdominal examination. On inspection, the shape and size of the abdomen is normal. Umbilicus is central and inverted. The corresponding quadrants move equally with respiration. There are no scar, sinuses, dilated veins, visible pulsations on the abdomen, and hernial orifices are intact. Palpation. There's no tenderness. Mass is felt in the midline arising from the pelvis and the size corresponds to 16 weeks gravid uterus size. The mass is firm in consistency and the borders are well defined and smooth. All the borders except the lower border is well made out. The mass is mobile from side to side.
Okay, on inspection you couldn't make out any suprapubic bulge, is it? Because it is 16 week gravid uterine size you said. And on inspection, there was no bulge?
Ma'am, couldn't make out.
Yeah, it was examined 1 year back, right?
Yes.
I don't remember. Okay. See, 16 weeks means usually you will be able to make, she's not very obese also, right?
Yes.
See, obese woman, it's difficult. Only on palpation you may be able to do, find out. I'm just asking, you may be right also, I don't know. You know, on inspection, everything was normal. I see many of the time, women know, they'll have lower abdominal fat. So you may not be able to make out up to 16 week size unless it is really huge. You cannot make out that, okay, there is a mass or there is a distension of the lower abdomen. Okay, you may be right. Okay, but you should be like, you should know. A thin lady coming with 16 week gravity, definitely you can make out that some suprapubic bulge, some abnormality will be there. Okay.
Yes.
You should be careful in saying if you have not seen this, boldly say no, there was no bulge, nothing. On inspection, nothing was there. Only on palpation, I could make out that there was a mass. Okay, fine. Next.
On percussion, dull note was heard over the mass and on auscultation, normal bowel sounds heard. Bimanual pelvic examination not done.
Okay.
Provisional diagnosis. A 42-year-old lady presented with prolonged heavy menstrual bleeding and dysmenorrhea since 4 months. On examination, a firm, non-tender mass of 16-week gravid uterus size in midline can be palpated. It's a case of abnormal uterine bleeding and probably due to fibroid uterus, AUBL.
So you are telling it is AUBL. Why do you say, what are the points which are in favor of your diagnosis?
Ma'am, actually I was thinking it could be AUBL or AUBA based on the history, but in examination, the mass is 16-week gravid uterus size, and generally AUBA doesn't grow to be that big. It's generally around 12 weeks size.
So, yeah, you must give always differential diagnosis. Okay, and the first diagnosis AUBL, there is always an exception for rule. Okay, so AUBA nowadays we have seen, you know, uterus up to 24 weeks also. Adenomyoma, understood?
Yes.
So, second diagnosis, you can put it as AUBA also, understood? Sometimes exceptionally, you may get, of course, for your level, even if you write AUBL, it's okay, okay? You are not thinking of any, okay, one knee's mass up to 16 week size with congestion, anything else? I will say it is a pelvic kidney.
Ma'am, she doesn't have any other complaints suggestive of
what complaint she will have. Pelvic kidney means she may not have any urinary disturbances, understood?
Yes.
So only on accidentally also sometimes you may find it. Okay.
Okay.
So why do you say it is? You are right, your diagnosis, you are right, but you should substantiate it. Strong, you must be strong.
The mass is in the midline and
okay.
It moves from side to side.
Yeah.
So I was, I couldn't feel the lower borders.
Yes, very good. So you couldn't make out that the lower borders, most probably it is a, a tumor coming from the uterus.
Yes.
You got that point? Yeah. So most probably it is a uterine tumor. And what else?
Ma'am, it could be an ovarian mass, but yes, ma'am.
It could be ovarian tumor also. You can't say. See, sometimes ovarian tumor, if it doesn't have a big pedicle, it may still like lower border may not be felt, one thing. And your functioning ovarian tumor will be still solid only, right?
Yes.
So that's why, so you have to write, it could be AUBL, it could be AUBA, or it could be a hormone producing ovarian tumor still. That's why you will go for investigations. Understood? Okay. Yes. But and you must substantiate it. I thought you would tell me about your menorrhagia, heavy menstrual bleeding.
Yes, ma'am.
Heavy menstrual bleeding, a midline mass where you couldn't make out, that is a solid mass where you couldn't make out the lower border. The most common cause could be leiomyoma.
Yes, ma'am.
Understood. That's how. See, symptoms you must correlate with your signs, clinical signs. Okay. So most probably it could be AUBL. What are the other differential diagnoses? If anybody asks, then you can tell about other things.
Yes, ma'am.
Which are less common, okay, in this case particularly. Right? Now, so what are the investigation that you would like to do in this case?
Ma'am, first in urine pregnancy test. And also trans vaginal ultrasound scan, and
so you will do a urine pregnancy test.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine, very good. Yeah.
Ma'am, then a USG trans vaginal.
You don't want to do any hematological investigations.
Yes, ma'am.
What are the blood investigation that you would like to do?
Ma'am, complete blood count, especially hemoglobin, to look at the hemoglobin status.
She's pale, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
See, correction of anemia is very, very important, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So, complete blood count you will do. Okay, fine.
Ma'am, then thyroid function tests.
Okay. Yeah, there could be associated because now the diagnosis is there. Doesn't mean to say that she's not having hypothyroidism, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So thyroid function test you might do. Yes, I agree with you. Then,
ma'am, then perspeculum vaginal examination.
Any other this thing? You don't want to rule out any diabetes. Can she have diabetes also?
Yes, ma'am. In the history, she said she doesn't, but we should still...
So you'll rule out that also because, in India, any woman comes for anything, I think you have to rule out these things.
Yes, ma'am.
Diabetes, okay? Diabetes, India is capital city for diabetes. So whenever she comes to some other problem, you always rule out diabetes, okay? At least FBS, PPBS or RBS you can do and then if there is any... This thing you can go for the detailed test, okay? Mm-hmm. And if you are planning for surgery, definitely you will have to rule out diabetes, right?
Yes, yes. And if you are planning for surgery, then even HBsAg, HIV, and also pre-op workup like ECG and
okay, fitness. Right. Now she's 42-year-old lady. Okay, she has got this 16-week fibroid uterus. And what you are planning to do for her?
Ma'am, on the USG, based on the USG report.
Okay, USG report is there is an intramural myoma of 6 cm size.
Ma'am, we can do a myomectomy.
What are the problems with myomectomy?
And
when do you do myomectomy?
Ma'am, myomectomy are done when there are not many fibroids.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's not like that, isn't it? Myomectomy is done usually when the woman is young and she's having infertility. She wants to conceive. In such women, yes, you can go ahead and do a myomectomy. I'm not telling that, okay, you know, young woman should not undergo myomectomy. Now, what, like, suppose when you do a myomectomy, what are the things that you're going to counsel her?
Ma'am, actually, for this patient, medical management would...
You want to give her medical management, is it? You're confused.
Yes, ma'am, medical management, ma'am.
What medical management you want to give?
Ma'am, we can, for the heavy menstrual bleeding and the pain, we can start on mefenamic acid or...
Now, see, that's what I think last week, last case was most probably without any findings, right? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
This time you had one mass per abdomen, that's why you wanted to, you know, you were very happy and you wanted to present this case. That is the confusion you are having now. Understood?
Mm-hmm.
See, whenever your diagnosis is fibroid, then you are not going for any of these hormones, especially when a woman is 42 years old. Remember that. Understood?
Yes.
She has completed her family. You ask her like whether she is interested in having a child. Last delivery was 17 years old. I don't think, you know, by all means, like, she may not be wanting to have another baby. Understood?
Yes.
So in this case, especially, you know, leiomyomas, when you do a myomectomy, there is a chance for recurrence. Understood? They keep on recurring. That's the problem. And it may not treat a heavy menstrual bleeding many a times. Understood? So with all these, and sometimes when you do myomectomy, the bleeding will be so much so that you may end up doing hysterectomy. So all these things you may have to counsel her in the beginning itself. Understood?
Yes.
Now, for all you know, a 42-year-old woman who is having last childbirth 17 years back, and she has almost completed her family, she would be wanting to have a hysterectomy only, if you ask me. Understood? Okay.
Yes.
So medical line of management, because you said medical line of management for fibroid, what are the cases that you select? I don't deny.
Ma'am, if it's a younger patient who wants to...
She's young, only 42 years, not very old, okay?
Ma'am, if it's premenopausal, then right after menopause, it can regress and become smaller in size. So we can just
try
that period.
So in such a situation, what is the medical treatment that you're going to give? Say premenopausal woman comes.
Ma'am, in a premenopausal woman, we can give OCPs or progesterone.
No. See, that's why you must be very specific. I think you're totally confused with the AUBO and AUBEL.
Okay.
Understood?
Hmm.
What is this AUBL, AUBO? What is this? What is this classification?
Ma'am, the palm coin classification.
Yeah, what is palm and what is coin?
Palm are the structural causes of abnormal uterine bleeding, and coin is the non-structural causes.
The non-structural causes. Okay, I'm not going to ask you what is it. You don't elaborate. Okay, now I presume that you know that. Okay, so it was introduced by the FIGO in 2011.
Mm-hmm.
So this is commonly, followed now. Okay, structural and non-structural causes. Now, earlier we used to have, you know, primary AUB and secondary AUB. Primary means it is, when you don't find any pelvic pathology, and there was a, terminology given like DUB and things like that. All those things are gone now, okay? Now, you should only find out whether she has got any structural causes or there are no structural causes, okay? The bleeding is because of that or this. So, you are confusing with the non-structural. Structural causes. You got that point?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So remember, any woman who is above 40 years old, and if the fibroid is more than say 5 centimeters, then usually it's better she undergoes hysterectomy, because there is always chance of recurrence. And secondly, there could be, this menorrhagia may not subside because of myomectomy. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
So myomectomy is preferably done for a younger lady who is wanting to conceive, whose main problem is infertility. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, because I'm sure like you have read about non-structural causes, I will talk about non-structural causes. We will deal with that. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, in this case, I would rather like it, it's best would be to do a hysterectomy. Now, hysterectomy, what hysterectomy will do? Total hysterectomy, bilateral salpingo hysterectomy, or what you want to do? 42-year-old lady.
Ma'am, total hysterectomy and not removing the ovaries because...
Yeah. So why you like, you know, sometimes you remove ovaries, sometimes you don't remove ovaries. What is that you are bothered about?
Ma'am, since she's 42, we shouldn't have like early menopausal symptoms.
Yeah, she should not have surgical menopause. Okay. Yes. Or iatrogenic because of you. She should not have menopause. One thing. Okay. And suppose you retain the ovary, what is the problem? Always we are dicey about these things, you know, right?
Hmm. Ma'am, even after retaining the ovary, there can be menopausal symptoms because of blood supply.
No, what are you worried when you retain the ovary?
Ma'am, there could be like any malignancy in the ovary.
Yes. See, you are worried about ovarian cancer. Understood? When you retain the ovary. When you remove the ovary, you are worried about menopausal symptoms. You got that point?
Yes.
That's why, you know, nowadays, even at 50 years, we don't remove the ovaries unless they are deceased. On examination, if you find that it is deceased ovary, you don't remove the ovaries. Understood? See, age of menopause is advanced. We don't know. Maybe she will attain menopause at 52 or 53 year old. Mm-hmm. Let her have the full benefit of the ovarian function, right? Even after hysterectomy, the ovaries keep functioning for some more years. Understood?
Yes.
So that's why only when they are deceased, you are going to remove the ovaries. Otherwise, you don't remove. But to reduce the risk of cancer, you can remove only the fallopian tubes. Understood? When you remove the fallopian tubes, they say the risk of ovarian cancer is reduced by almost like 30 to 64%. Okay. So what you can do is a hysterectomy, total hysterectomy with bilateral salpingectomy. Why you want to do bilateral salpingectomy is to reduce the risk of ovarian cancer because you are going to retain the ovaries. That's all. Yes. If you are telling like that. Now for your standard, if you say, I want to do hysterectomy, I will not remove the ovaries, that is good enough. You got that point? So this, removing the fallopian tubes and retaining the ovaries, that will fetch you one extra mark. That's all. Understood? You are smart.
Yes.
Right? So what route? You want to do vaginal, you want to do abdominal, you want to laparoscopy, robotic. What do you want to do? Which route you will?
If possible, then vaginal route. And since she's already a Paris, so it might be easier to do a vaginal route.
Also. Yes, yes. So because of all the advantages of vaginal hysterectomy, still you can do, you know. Of course, general opinion is that any uterus less than 12 weeks, you have to do vaginal hysterectomy. Always you should give an attempt, okay. But up to 16 weeks, 18 weeks, depending upon the surgeon's expertise, you can debulk, do the myomectomy from vaginal route and remove the uterus also. Understood? You can debulk it and remove it from vaginal route. So other options are, of course, if you are expert in laparoscopy, the next option would be laparoscopy. The third option would be abdominal hysterectomy. Understood?
Yes.
Robotic anyway, we don't have, of course. Robotic would be a second option if at all you have. So vaginal first, robotic next, next laparoscopy next would be your abdominal. Abdominal should be always the last resort,
yes,
because of all the complications, right? So that's about the hysterectomy. Now suppose you think that there were no findings, there was no mass, okay? There was no mass. Then how would you proceed?
Ma'am, if there was no mass, then if there was...
Neha, let's just pause. Here, what kind of ultrasound examination you would do for this case?
Transvaginal ultrasound.
No. See, it is palpable per abdomen. That's what I wanted to tell you.
Okay.
It is a transabdominal scan here.
Okay.
Understood? So whenever it is above pubic symphysis, Okay, it is palpable per abdomen. You better do a transabdominal scan, because when you do a transvaginal scan, you are probe. You know, it will not catch the whole picture of the uterus. Understood?
Mm-hmm.
It will be beyond its resolution. Understood?
Yes.
So any pelvic masses, transvaginal scan. So if you had not felt any mass per abdomen, then you would go for transvaginal scan.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. So when you do a transvaginal scan, okay, what all things you have to make out?
Mom, I'd like to see the endometrial thickness.
First is size of the uterus, right?
Size of the uterus.
Mm.
If any mass or anything is present.
Where mass?
Mm.
Should be specific. See, if it is less than 12 weeks, doesn't mean to say that she should not have fibroid, right?
Yes, ma'am. She could still have.
So the texture of the uterus is important. Understood?
Yes.
So by transvaginal scan, you will check the size of the uterus. You will check the echo texture of the uterus. Okay. So echo texture will tell you whether there is any fibroids, that is leiomyoma, or there is adenomyoma.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Hmm.
Do you know what would be the ultrasound picture like in adenomyoma and what would be the picture in leiomyoma?
Ma'am, in leiomyoma, we'll have a well-defined mass with a pseudocapsule. Hmm. And if depending on the fiber and the smooth muscle component, it could be hypoechoic or it could even be isoechoic with the myometrium.
Okay.
Adenomyosis, there's an honeycomb pattern. And the margin between the junction of the endometrium and myometrium is not made out clearly. And the posterior wall is, the posterior part is thicker.
Very good, yeah. Yes. And there could be something called as acoustic shadowing, okay? So cystic spaces in the myometrium, that will give that honeycomb appearance, you know? So that's why the texture is important. Okay. So you yourself told me if it is less than 12 weeks, I would have thought about adenomyosis because she has got congestive dysmenorrhea, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that will differentiate between adenomyosis and adenomyoma and leiomyoma. Okay. So there's a difference between adenomyoma and adenomyosis. What is that difference?
Ma'am, adenomyosis is uniform enlargement of, it's uniform, and adenomyoma is it's localized.
Yeah, so if it is focal, one single means it is adenomyoma. If it is diffuse, it will be adenomyosis. Okay, you are very right. So that's the transvaginal scan. And then what else?
Ma'am,
size, echo texture, you said endometrial thickness. Anything else you want to see?
Ma'am, we can, if we use, we can also see the blood vessels if we use like a Doppler study.
Don't you want to focus on the adnexal pathology?
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
yeah,
ma'am.
You will also look at the adnexa. Okay, these are the things that you look when you do a transvaginal scan. Okay, so you have done a transvaginal scan and it says that, okay, uterus is about 10 centimeter long. Okay. So it is 10 centimeter by 6 by 5, whatever, I would say. And there is the echo texture is normal, okay? There is nothing, no fibroids. Adnexa is normal. Endometrial thickness is 12 millimeter. No, 14 millimeter, I would say. 14 millimeter.
And we should go for an endometrial biopsy then.
What would be your diagnosis?
Ma'am, it could be endometrial hyperplasia.
No, your diagnosis is most probably AUBO.
AUBO, okay. Yes.
Yeah. So your diagnosis is AUBO. Understood?
Mm.
Now you will go for endometrial biopsy.
Yes, ma'am.
So now you should know like when you should call her for endometrial biopsy. When will you call her for endometrial biopsy?
Ma'am, premenstrual.
Premenstrual, very good. Now her hemoglobin is 7 grams.
Ma'am, we should correct the anemia first.
So you correction of anemia is important. Okay. So you will call her for endometrial biopsy. Now, suppose she were to be a 30-year-old, 32-year-old lady coming with a similar history, okay? Then would you do endometrial biopsy now?
Ma'am, we could do aspiration, endometrial aspiration.
Always, nowadays, endometrial biopsy is not by DNC, understood? You will go for PIPELS endometrial aspiration curate and then you will aspirate it and send it, okay? It's good enough. And it's very, very, very simple procedure. Outpatient procedure also, very painless procedure, very comfortable one. And it is as sensitive as your DNC, understood?
Yes.
So everything like endometrial biopsy is by PIPELS, okay? But, you know, whether you will do in a younger lady endometrial biopsy first, that's what I'm asking you. Ultrasound is normal. Ultrasound. Even if it is, say, 14 millimeter endometrium, 32-year-old lady. Okay, I will tell you. So if the woman is above 40 years, definitely endometrial biopsy is a must. Understood?
Yes.
First, you will give her treatment and see if she doesn't respond to your treatment, the usual conventional treatment, then only you can go for endometrial biopsy. You can defer it later to a later date. Understood? But if she is above 40, always you should do an endometrial biopsy. But anything else you would like to do? You have called her.
Ma'am, if she has...
Now, one more thing is, suppose you are allowed to do a examination, what all you would look for? She is having a heavy menstrual bleeding. She is coming to you. Upper abdomen, nothing you have felt. What else? Next examination would be what?
Per-vaginal and speculum examination.
First per speculum, you must say per speculum first,
yes,
and then per vaginal examination. Okay, so it is not just per vaginal examination; it is a bimanual pelvic examination. Understood?
Yes.
So you will do a per speculum examination first, and then bimanual pelvic examination. Mm-hmm. So you have done that, and then you will send her for a transvaginal scan, and these are the findings. And you are anything else you want to see? Want to do any other investigation? 42-year-old lady coming without any mass now.
Without any mass.
Do you want to do pap smear?
Yes, ma'am. Pap smear, yes. Is.
Pap smear is a must. Understood. So suppose she has not undergone pap smear earlier, definitely you are going to do pap smear even for a 30-year-old lady. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
So carcinoma screening is very, very important. It should be an opportunistic smear.
Okay.
So your thyroid examination, ruling out diabetes, ruling out breast cancer, whenever a woman comes for any other complaint, and ruling out carcinoma cervix. You have to take that opportunity and do all these things and rule out these problems. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So you are taking a pap smear also, right? So suppose she's got bleeding, she's coming in the bleeding phase, okay? See, there are two phases, one, acute and chronic phase. Mm-hmm. Acute AUB means what?
If it's like a severe bleeding, then she could have vitals unstable.
Yes. So acute AUB means the patient who needs immediate intervention. Understood? Mm-hmm.
Yes, ma'am.
So you may have to hospitalize her and you may have to give her treatment and things like that, okay? Chronic AUB is?
Her vitals are stable and doesn't require immediate intervention.
And you are just telling the opposite. The bleeding which lasts for more than 6 months, understood? This abnormal type of bleeding lasting for more than six months, you call it as chronic AUB. Okay. See, sometimes there'll be transient disturbances. Many a times, you know, they will say, last menses I had this heavy bleeding. I tell her, suppose she's 32 years, wait for one more cycle, let us see what is going to happen. Understood? So just like that, one cycle, two cycle, we usually don't bother much. But if it is chronic, say more than 6 months, definitely she will need investigation.
Yes.
And treatment. Understood. So that's how you have to, you know, decide like whether she needs intervention or what. Now, patient has come to you with acute AUB, okay? And you are sending the, suppose she has come in the chronic phase, maybe you will call her for the premenstrual, this thing, okay, phase, endometrial biopsy. Now she has got bleeding. She wants it to be stopped. What you will do?
Ma'am, dilatation and curettage to stop acute bleeding because the...
before that, you want to give her something. It's not always DNC first.
Ma'am, we can give her progesterone or high dose estrogen.
Okay. She has got high blood pressure. Any non-hormonal treatment is available?
Ma'am, like a tamponade? Not sure.
Don't you see, she has got dysmenorrhea, she has got heavy menstrual bleeding. You give her mefenamic acid?
Yes, ma'am.
Understood. So, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs would be first line of drug in AUBO. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Right? When there is no pathology, even for say fibroids, suppose they come with heavy menstrual bleeding, the first thing is we will think about reducing the amount of bleeding. Understood? So, you give mefenamic acid. Okay? Anything else you can give?
Tranexamic acid.
Yeah, antifibrinolytics you can give. So usually tranexamic acid will reduce the flow by almost 50%, you know.
Yes.
And mefenamic acid will reduce the flow by almost 30-40%. It will reduce the flow. Mm-hmm. What is the dosage, mefenamic acid? Any idea?
Ma'am, thrice a day, 500 milligram thrice a day, ma'am.
Yeah, it is 500 milligram, 3 times daily, usually. And usually for 2 or 3 days, because it is only symptomatic treatment. Understood? She's coming to you for the first time, for first cycle. You can give her and tell her, okay, we'll see in the next cycle. Understood?
Yes.
Suppose she is not responding to that, maybe you can try this tranexamic acid also. Okay? Tranexamic acid is slightly more expensive as compared to mefenamic acid. So you can give, what is the dosage?
Ma'am, I'm not sure of tranexamic acid.
Yeah, tranexamic acid also comes as 500 milligram tablet, but the dosage is always 3 to 4 gram per day. You should remember that. It is 2 TID or 2 QID. Many a times, the gynecologists themselves, okay, they are specialists. In spite of that, they'll give 500 milligram BID. Bleeding will not stop many a times. So they think that, okay, tranexamic acid has not acted. But the correct dosage is 3 to 4 gram per day. Okay, you only when she doesn't respond to this, then you can think about giving progesterones. Okay, next is hormone. Okay, suppose she doesn't respond to any of these, then you can give her progesterones. Okay, what is the progesterone that you give to stop bleeding?
I don't remember, ma'am.
Oh, you somebody else is there? Anybody? Okay, it's almost 7:30 now. I'll only answer. So usually we give norethisterone acetate. Understood? 19 non-testosterone derivatives, especially if a woman is elderly, like say 40 year and above. Suppose she were to be young lady, say 18, 20 year old or puberty menorrhagia, I would give her medroxyprogesterone acetate. Understood? It is 17 alpha hydroxyprogesterone derivative, which doesn't have so much of androgenic effect. Okay, in a young girl, I don't want her to get exposed to the androgenic effect of the progesterone. So I will prefer medroxyprogesterone acetate for a younger girl. Got that point?
Yes, ma'am.
If she were to be a little elderly lady, norethisterone I will give because a short course may not have so much effect on her and it may not harm her so much like for an adolescent girl, one thing. Second thing is norethisterone acetate is more stronger drug as far as bleeding is concerned. Understood? It will stop the bleeding almost immediately, sort of. Understood. So that's the reason. Of course, this is more powerful, norethisterone acetate. So that's a preferred drug for an elderly girl, elderly lady, mainly because the androgenic effect may not be so bad for her. Okay. Right. So what is the dosage? So medroxyprogesterone acetate comes as 10 milligram tablet. Usually 20 to 30 milligram you give to stop the bleeding, which usually happens in about, say, 24 to 48 hours. Okay. Now, once she stops the bleeding, progesterone, she will have what is known as withdrawal bleeding, right? So in order to prevent that, usually what we do is you continue the therapy, one tablet of progesterone a day for 10, 20 days. Once the bleeding stops. Understood? So that will give her one full cycle. Got the point?
Yes.
Okay. Now, meanwhile, suppose you had endometrial biopsy report and it shows that there is hyperplastic endometrium or, say, proliferative ovulatory disturbance, you can give her for another next cycle also progesterone tablet or even combined oral contraceptive pill if there are no other contraindications. Okay. So there are, for combined oral contraceptive pill, there could be some contraindications, especially the estrogen pill. Say she is having severe hypertension or cardiovascular disease or history of any thromboembolic diseases in the past. I may not give her estrogen containing pill. You got that point? So she may have to be given only the progesterone pill. So for continuation of the cycle, you may start from 5th to 25th day. For another six cycles, you may give six odds. It depends upon, after six cycles, you can always call her back and see like whether the bleeding has stopped and things like that. Okay. If it is AUBO, usually there could be correction with these drugs, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So progesterone to stop the bleeding in acute phase and continuation of the cycles. Or suppose she comes with a chronic AUB, I would rather give her only progesterone maybe from 5th to 25th day or combined oral contraceptive pill from 5th to 25th day. That's all. Got that point?
Yes, ma'am.
So she can be given either CSC, combined hormonal pill, or she can be given progesterone only. So preferred progesterone would be norethisterone. Okay. Now suppose she is a younger lady, say 30, 32 year old lady, and then she doesn't want her ovulation to be suppressed. Okay. In that case, or even if she conceives, there should not be any problem on the fetus by chance if she has conceived. You would prefer dihydrogestosterone acetate. Okay. There are different kinds of progesterone and you have to select the progesterone hormone depending upon her age and her desirability to conceive and things like that. So any abnormal uterine bleeding, the treatment is depending upon the patient's age, the pathology, and her desire to conceive, her desire to retain the uterus. Understood?
Mm-hmm.
Of course. If it is a CS cervix and all, we may not think about all these things at all. We may aggressively treat her, isn't it?
Yes.
So this is pathology also is very important, right? If we are talking about AUBO, only ovulation disturbances, if there is anything, how to manage. So acute phase, we'll be giving progesterone to stop the bleeding and continuation of that cycle, one tablet a day for 20 days and she'll have withdrawal bleeding. Now, progesterone withdrawal bleeding usually will be less as compared to estrogen withdrawal bleeding. You know that, isn't it?
Yes.
Why?
Ma'am, estrogen causes proliferation of the endometrium. And when we give progesterone along with supporting the endometrium, it decreases the estrogen receptors.
Yes.
So it decreases.
So there'll be thinning of the endometrium, one thing. Okay. And even it decreases. So that's enough. Like thinning of the endometrium, that's why there is less of bleeding. Okay. So that is one thing. Okay. Now, what are the other drugs? What are the other drugs that can be given? She has got some contraindication for this hormonal pill. She is not responding to your NSAIDs or antifibrinolytics. What else you can give?
Ma'am, GnRH agonists.
GnRH analog, you usually know it has got its own problem. Anything else can be given? Any non-steroidal pill you remember? Have you heard of selective estrogen receptor modulator, armiloxifen?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So you can give armiloxifen. Usually it is given as, you know, for contraception also. You must have heard, like in Vani Villas Hospital, that there is a tablet called as Chaya.
Mm-hmm.
Chaya is 30 milligram. Okay. They give twice weekly and for the first 3 months and once weekly for contraception purpose. Same tablet, you give 60 milligram, double the dose, 60 milligram twice weekly for the first 3 months and 60 milligram once weekly for another 3 months. Okay. So 3 months, 3 months, total 6 months you can give treatment. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So you can give armiloxifen, that is a selective estrogen receptor modulator. Now, earlier we had this selective estrogen receptor, selective progesterone receptor modulator also, uliprystal acetate, but now it is gone out of the market mainly because of the fear of liver cancer and things like that, okay? Mm-hmm. So, earlier the uliprystal acetate was given even for fibroid as a medical treatment. I didn't discuss anything about medical treatment of fibroid, okay? So, just mm-hmm. forget it now. Now, we are talking only about AUB, so you folks here now. Okay, so what are the medication that can be given? So you can give progesterone only, and out of the progesterone, there are various types. There is something called as gestrinone, that is also a third generation progesterone, which is quite useful, 2.5 milligram twice weekly, convenient dosage, you know, that can be given. And if there is any, you can give for the continuation, you can give either progesterone alone or you can give combined hormonal pill. If there are any contraindications, you can go for armiloxifen, or you can give, there's something called as anti-estrogens. Okay. What are anti-estrogens? Are danazol.
Yes.
So suppose you suspect adenomyosis or endometriosis, very good drug actually speaking, but only problem is the androgenic effect. Yeah. So danazol 100 to 200 milligram BID, you can give that also. So last resort would be your GnRH analog. Okay.
Yes.
So gestrinone also is one of the progesterone which can be used. Okay.
Hmm.
Okay. Now, anything else? Now she is 42 year old, this year woman. Okay. She is para 2, not vectomized, not using any contraceptive. Okay. The endometrium, when you take a biopsy, it comes as simple hyperplasia. Which one will you give?
If it's simple hyperplasia, then ma'am, OCPs or?
What would be the better option? You want to give her, she is 42-year-old lady, isn't it? Not very young also. Contraception plus something progesterone. What you can very good. LNG IUS is the best option for her. Understood. See, you have done a biopsy. There is hyperplastic endometrium. That means there is an ovulation. So best would be LNG IUS. Understood. Now, have you heard of these minimal invasive surgeries? See, patient is not responding to any of your these drugs. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. There are two generations of minimally invasive surgeries, and it is to like ablate, like laser. There are, like, for example, laser ablation or cryoablation or thermal ablation of the endometrium. Very
no, slow, Neha. What is first generation ablation technique?
Ma'am, first generation requires.
Be very focused. Okay, first generation means what?
My first generation requires a resectoscope and requires
hysteroscope. You need a hysteroscope. You need an expert who is expert in hysteroscope. Understood?
Yes.
So expertise in hysteroscopy is needed for first generation ablation techniques. Okay. They're all your TCRE, transcervical resection of the endometrium, either using your diathermy coagulation, okay, loop or resectoscope, that is called loop resectoscope, or roller ball, or you can use even laser, NDR laser, okay. Nowadays, of course, you have to distend the uterus with the media, glycine, it will be when and it will be a prolonged procedure sometimes. So glycine will have its own side effects like pulmonary edema, overloading of the circulation. All those things can happen. Okay, so that's why nowadays they are doing this with bipolar coagulation. So glycine is not needed. Even with normal saline also you can, and glycine is a bit expensive. Okay, so you can do that. But this first generation, definitely you need hysteroscope and all those things, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So that's why the second generation ablation techniques have come, which are equally effective. You got that point?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So the most commonly used is? Have you heard of thermal balloon?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So see, so you can heat the endometrium, you can microwave it. Mm-hmm. Okay, you can burn it. Burn is first generation, okay? Mm-hmm. Microwave ablation or heating using this thermal balloon. Same thing, 70 to 80% it is effective. Remember that, okay? You are distending, you put one balloon, distend it with the saline and heat it up.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And it will be with contact of the endometrium. So usually, say about 13 millimeter endometrium will not be destroyed. So for all these ablation techniques, the endometrium only about say 4 to 5 millimeter can be ablated. So that is why these women will need pre-operative thinning of the endometrium, so which can be possible by giving your GnRH analog. Understood? Yes, so you give GnRH analog, and that will naturally cause sort of artificial menopause kind of thing, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. So it is a medical oophorectomy, right? Yes. So when you give GnRH analog, so there'll be thinning of the endometrium. Usually 2 or 3 injections they give preoperatively and then go for this ablation techniques. You got that point? So nowadays they have come up with the NovaSure. NovaSure is a bipolar radio frequency induced coagulation of the endometrium or a vaporization of the endometrium. They vaporize the endometrium and it lasts only 90 seconds. Okay. So that is the recent this thing, NovaSure or cryo, as you said, you can freeze the endometrium using minus temperature, okay? So, and you can destroy the endometrium. So these are the various ablative techniques. Now, all these ablative techniques have been replaced by your LNG IUS. Remember that, understood? So that is why you can straight away, like when patient doesn't respond to all these, your medical therapy, if the uterus is not more than 12 centimeter and endometrium is not very thick, you can straight away go for LNG IUS. Even a small fibroid which is not distorting the uterine cavity, endometrial cavity, even if she is having adenomyosis, all these lesions can be taken care by LNG IUS. Understood?
Yes.
So LNG IUS, you should never forget, right? Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, if she doesn't respond to any of these things, or else, like, I don't want to have all these procedures, 70 to 80%, and some 10% may undergo hysterectomy, they may come back for hysterectomy because these are all, conservative line of treatment, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if she says that, oh, no, I cannot keep on coming for all these things, I want to undergo hysterectomy, a 42-year-old lady, definitely you can do hysterectomy also.
Yes.
But always you must counsel her for, because there is a good, this thing, LNG IUS definitely might treat her, okay? You can go for LNG IUS and then you can think about hysterectomy as a last resort in these cases, when it is AUBO, okay? Now, irregular ripening, and I want to tell you something about metropathia hemorrhagica. Okay, what is the kind of history patient will have in metropathia hemorrhagica?
Ma'am, they could have amenorrhea for a few months and then have prolonged continuous bleeding, and it's generally painless.
Yeah, so usually it will be painless mainly because it is?
It's anovulatory.
So. Anovulatory type of bleeding. Okay, fine. So, in this metropathia hemorrhagica kind of thing, in this kind of patients, you will get this endometrium as hyperplastic endometrium. Remember that, okay? So these are the women who may not respond to your medical therapy, who may need either ablation or thing like, you know, come to think of that, like you can even use LNG IUS. Understood? So rest of the women can be managed with your combined oral contraceptive pill or even progesterone pills also. Okay. And irregular ripening, have you heard of this irregular ripening and irregular shedding? You all already mentioned, isn't it?
Yes.
So this irregular ripening, what would be the symptom like? What complaint she will have?
Ma'am, the cycles will be irregular.
It's not irregular. Like it's like, you know, just because it is irregular ripening doesn't mean to say that it is cycles will be irregular. They are ovular cycles. Understood? What happens is because of irregular ripening and premature degeneration of the corpus luteum, there may be premenstrual spotting. She may have premenstrual spotting followed by 1 or 2 days of normal flow, and then her cycle will complete like that. Okay. So for such women, it's better to give progesterone therapy, especially in the 5th to 25th day, she can have this progesterone therapy, irregular ripening. It doesn't have any connection with the implantation, sorry. And then irregular shedding. What do you mean by irregular shedding? You said it is the prolonged function of the corpus luteum. So yes, what is the symptom patient can have? So she will have postmenstrual spotting. So she has got her menstruation followed by some kind of bleeding, spotting for a few more days. So the cycles are shortened, kind of, you know. She will have she will have bleeding more days and rest period will be less. Got that point? Yes. So for such women also, for irregular shedding, you can either give combined hormonal pill or you can give progesterone from 5th to 25th day. That's what I wanted to tell you. This thing about adolescent puberty menorrhagia. Suppose a girl, say a 16-year-old girl is brought to you with heavy menstrual bleeding. She's very anemic. How will you go?
Ma'am, we'll manage the anemia and at that age, it could be because of immaturity of the HPO axis. Mm. In some time, it may get regularized and the symptoms might go. So for now, for reassurance and managing of the...
No, puberty menorrhagia, as you said, it could be ovulation disturbance is one thing, okay? What is most important thing? Like, what is the most serious thing which you should rule out in this case?
Coagulation disorders.
Yes. See, in almost 25% of the cases, it may manifest as puberty menorrhagia, this coagulation abnormalities for the first time. Understood? So on probing, then she might give history of, say, epistaxis or some bleeding gums and things like that. So first thing is you have to rule out coagulation abnormalities in this case. So complete blood count is very important. Mm-hmm. Not only to rule out coagulation abnormalities, she could have other blood dyscrasias, like, say, leukemia. Yes. So you have to rule out leukemia. Understood? Mm-hmm. That is one thing. And second thing is, you said about ovulation disturbance is the most common. Say sometimes if they are obese and all that, you can make out by look itself, polycystic ovarian disease. Yeah. So they can have polycystic ovarian disease. So they can either come with heavy menstrual bleeding or they may come with oligomenorrhea and things like that. Okay. That is one thing. And in suspected cases, you may have to rule out tubercular endometritis. So if you're suspecting, say there is a family history of tuberculosis, how will you rule out tuberculosis in this girl? In about 44% of the cases, it could be tuberculosis, for all you know.
Ma'am, based on, in tuberculosis, there could be both more bleeding in the initial phases and then decreased in the later phases.
I see her mother, there is a history, you know, family history. Mother had tuberculosis, she was treated.
Huh. Ma'am, she could have even had some symptoms like cough and other symptoms, respiration.
She's not very sure.
Okay.
You better always have a chest x-ray in this case. Understood?
Yes.
what is this adhesions and all will come in the later picture. Understood. She has come with menorrhagia means you are always thinking of acute tubercular endometritis, right?
Yes.
So you may have to take chest X-ray and you have to do a PCR or BACTEC testing of the menstrual blood.
Okay.
Understood. You have to rule out tuberculosis in her case. Okay. Because genital tuberculosis is always secondary to her tubercular disease somewhere else. Okay. So it's better always you take one chest X-ray, do a Mantoux test, and then it may not be very specific. So you may do a culture, BACTEC testing or a PCR testing of the menstrual blood. Okay. That is one thing. And of course, she can have thyroid problems also. You have to do a thyroid function test. Hmm? You have to rule out blood dyscrasias like, see, sometimes you may have to do von Willebrand's disease. You may have to rule out von Willebrand disease. How will you rule out that?
Ma'am, if coagulation disorders, if she has a history of bleeding in the gums or like after the tooth falling, if there's...
Yeah, I want to rule out von Willebrand's because, you know, type 1 von Willebrand's, I can definitely treat her with desmopressin. So how to rule out any investigation?
Ma'am,
have you heard of ristocetin cofactor assay?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, that you can do on von Willebrand antigen assay itself. You can do. Sometimes it could be hemophilia. So factor 8, you may have to check for factor 8. So apart from, say, coagulation profile means what all you should check. PT, APTT. Mm-hmm. And you have to look for the blood count, see for the peripheral smear to rule out any leukemias, okay? Platelet count is important. It could be idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura also, ITP, yeah? And you also, very rarely, von Willebrand factor, you have to do that assay. Factor 8, you must rule out hemophilia and fibrinogen deficiency, okay? So all these things you must do if it is you are suspecting coagulation disorders or any blood dyscrasias where you want to rule out even leukemia. Understood?
Yes.
Okay. So thyroid test also you may have to do, thyroid function test, right? Now she is coming with the acute phase of bleeding. How will you manage? She is not responding to your non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. First, we have tried. Now, remember, even if she's a 16-year-old girl, tranexamic acid, you have to give 3 to 4 grams. Understood? The dosage doesn't alter.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, since she's a young child, we can't do dilatation and curettage. So we have to...
Done a transabdominal scan, okay? With full bladder, you got the transabdominal scan. Everything is normal. No ovarian tumors here. No ovarian tumor, no fibroids, nothing. Sometimes fibroid also can be there.
Ma'am, progesterone?
Okay, yeah, you can give progesterone. So here, which is the progesterone of choice?
not sure.
Hey, I told you in the beginning itself, without androgenic effect, which is the progesterone that is preferred for younger. See, somebody is telling medroxyprogesterone acetate.
Yes, ma'am.
So medroxyprogesterone acetate is the drug of choice. That's why I wanted to remind you again, okay?
Yes.
So you are giving about 20 to 30 milligram initially to stop the bleeding and continue 10 milligram every day for 20 days. Okay. You got that point?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, correction of anemia is very, very important. And now suppose she doesn't respond to the medroxyprogesterone also, what else?
Ma'am, high dose estrogen.
Yes. So here you can give estrogen. You got that point? So in young girl, you can give estrogen. Actually, they suggest estrogen injection, but I don't know whether this injection is available or not. 25 milligram of Premarin injection. It is the conjugated estrogen or the natural estrogen. It is given IV. And you repeat it every 6th hourly till the bleeding stops. So this usually happens within, say, 24 to 48 hours. Mm-hmm. Then you have to continue the cycle giving estrogen tablet. Estrogen tablet comes, okay? We have estriol tablet, estriol valerate, 2 milligram tablet. which can be given for the first 20 days. Okay, you give for 21 days. The last 10 days, you have to combine with the medroxyprogesterone acetate. Because you know that estrogen withdrawal bleeding is always heavier. We don't want her to get exposed to the unopposed action of estrogen, should not be there. So you give her in the last 10 days, again, progesterone. I don't know how much you have understood, how much has gone into your head, okay? Got that point?
Yes, ma'am.
Everything you can remember?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so estrogen has got a role in adult puberty menorrhagia. That you should remember, okay? So if it happens to be 1 milligrams, type 1, you can give desmopressin, okay? The treatment is possible. But anyway, whenever she has got coagulation abnormalities, you always give treatment in consultation with the hematologist.
Yes.
Understood. You will not give immediate. But remember one thing, like even progesterone sometimes will treat 1 Willebrand's disease. Okay. Even this thing. And younger girls, it's better not to give combined hormonal pill because it will suppress ovulation. Mm-hmm. Understood.
Yes.
So best is to give progesterone for maybe 3 months or 4 months and stop and see like if she's responding well and she's good, not quite comfortable, means you can stop the treatment altogether.
Mm-hmm.
Or else you can give only symptomatic, only non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs only during the cycle, and correction of anemia is the most important. That also sometimes they will respond very well. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
So that's the treatment. Can I put LNGIUS for this girl? Young girl?
No, ma'am. Okay. It's not used.
It's not used. Okay. Now there is actually LNGIUS, smaller LNGIUS, I don't know whether it is available in the market. Okay. It's called as Fibroplant. LNGIUS, how much of progesterone is released per day?
It is.
You should be smart. If you answer all these things, no, you'll get good marks in the exam. It's 20 microgram per day. Understood?
Okay.
So if there is something called as Fibroplant, smaller this thing, it releases only 14 microgram of progesterone, levonorgestrel. Per day. So that may be an ideal for younger women. Remember, young adolescents, you can give LNGIUS also. Only thing is there is a taboo, you know, like you have to, something is introduced into the uterine cavity, younger girl may not like anything inside. Understood?
Yes.
The taboo is there, okay? But nowadays, girls are smart. They use even intravaginal tampons and things like that. So for such girls, definitely we might as well use LNGIS.
Okay.
Right? If she doesn't respond. So it depends upon the kind of population that you get. A well-educated girl who is using vaginal tampon, or even nowadays you get that menstrual cup. Have you heard of that?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, very hygienic. Yeah, very economical. So menstrual cup, if she is using, you can introduce one LNGIS for her. Right?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
So these are some of the things I wanted to tell you. DMPA also can be used as a continuation of cycle. You can give for chronic AUB, you can give injection DMPA also. Okay. Okay, then. So I think you understood everything. So younger girls, as far as possible, try to avoid estrogens combined oral pills. Best would be non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. If she doesn't respond, then antifibrinolytic. If she still doesn't respond, you can give her progesterones. Medroxyprogesterone would be a better option than norethisterone because it is a 19-naught testosterone derivative. You don't want her to have any androgenic effect. Okay. And if she still doesn't respond, then you can think of giving high dose of estrogen followed by progesterone. Okay. And reproductive age group, again, if she's young and she doesn't have any other problem, it is a non-structural cause. And if you have ruled out all those endocrinological causes, still you can go in the same similar manner. But here you can continue the cycle with the combined oral contraceptive pill.
Yes.
Younger age group. Okay. the premenopausal women, again, like, you know, so, or if she has got any contraindication to estrogen pills, you can give only progesterone, okay? Or then you, otherwise, you must think about something else, like LNGI, UES, it can be given. Even if there is a contraindication to estrogen, you can give LNGI, UES, okay?
Okay.
The only thing is, like, say, history of breast carcinoma or history of thrombosis, right now, she's recently treated and all that. Such cases, you will avoid putting LNGI, UES. Otherwise, LNGI, UES is a very good option. Understood?
Mm-hmm.
So, the last option would be your surgical option. Understood?
Yes.
Minimal surgery also you can think about, but nowadays, this, all these minimal surgeries are replaced by LNGI, UES. So, if she doesn't respond to that, maybe you can think about hysterectomy.
Mm-hmm.
So, a smaller uterus, NDVH is the best. Next is laparoscopy. Remember that. Understood? NDVH is the first option. Non-descent vaginal hysterectomy, rather. Vaginal hysterectomy is the best option. Okay. I think you got everything, almost everything. I covered almost everything, I suppose. Let me see. Yeah, puberty menorrhagia, we have told, okay, I've told about all the, you know, age-wise, what are the differential diagnoses you can think of, causes for all this abnormal uterine bleeding. I think we almost covered almost everything, okay?
Yes.
Fibroid I have not touched because, you know, either you should go for this or you go for this.
Okay.
You can't have to do together, okay?
Yes.
So maybe fibroid in some other class.
Yes.
Okay, wish you all the best.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
We have exceeded so much time. You know, it's almost 8 o'clock now. Okay, fine. Yeah. Any doubts you have? Any doubts?
I'll check
any
on YouTube.
Chat
ma'am.
Box. Chat box. They are only answered. No questions.
YouTube.
Yeah.
Pallavi is checking on YouTube.
If there are any questions, then we will answer that and then we'll wind up.
Ma'am, there are no doubts in YouTube, ma'am.
I know. Because they were keeping on answering, some were wrong, some were right. I kept on telling then and there itself, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, then. Good luck, Neha.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, you must buck up.
Yes.
You have answered, but then if you answer a little bit in a smarter way, no, you will get more marks. That's all.
Yes.
Okay. These are the common cases that will be kept for your exams.
Mm-hmm.
Abnormal uterine bleeding, prolapse, one fibroid, one mass per abdomen. So all these things are common cases. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Good luck. Bye.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was indeed a very comprehensive clinical class. The discussion was very useful for us and we could learn a lot from you. Thank you so much, Dr. Malini ma'am, for teaching and guiding us. We'll ever grateful to you and we always need your guidance.
Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am. I'm happy that it was useful for you all. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
It was a great effort by the presenter, Ms. Neha. We could learn a lot from your presentation. Thank you, Ms. Neha.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
I also thank all the participants for the enthusiastic participation. Thank you, one and all.
Yeah, I'm happy that they were attentive and they were trying to answer. Okay. See, even if it is a wrong answer, doesn't matter. You have to attempt. Okay. Then you will know that you have answered it wrong. And when we say that it was wrong and this is right, you will remember it better.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Right off.